initial results, and once you have the fit, you forget about the ab initio results, right? So you are computing the parameters from first principles. In reality, what you have is these local degrees of freedom or local modes in each cell, and you can imagine them in many different configurations. So here I have arrows distributed homogeneously. This corresponds to the ferroelectric ground state, but you can also imagine anti-ferroelectric configurations like this. Here you have like head-to-head dipoles coming at each other. Here you have like a transversal modulation and other things. So every one of these you can compute ab initio, only once. You write down the energy, and essentially you fit the parameters of a rather complicated but still tractable Hamiltonian to reproduce those first principles results. Okay, just to give you a feeling of which kind of interactions go to these Hamiltonians, essentially at the harmonic level, what you have is long-range dipole-dipole interactions between these localized dipoles. You can also have short-range interactions, which typically are repulsive, meaning that they don't favor the ferroelectric instability. You have anharmonic terms that can, in principle, be very complicated, but actually can be approximated to a good very well by assuming that they are only on-site terms, etc., etc. In some way, this is like a glorified phi-4 model for those of you who like the literature on model systems for on model Hamiltonian for phase transitions, including dipole-dipole interactions and fitting all the parameters ab initio. You have elastic energies, you have couplings between elastics, between elasticity and dipoles, which are of course very important to account for things like electrostriction or piezoelectricity in the low symmetry phase. So you put all that, you compute the parameters from first principles, a few heavy but not very many calculations, doable calculations, and you have all you need to now try to run this sum, because you can evaluate the energies quickly and you sum over a relatively small space of configurations. And to run this sum, what you do is molecular dynamics or Monte Carlo. And so this is what these guys did in 1994, the first material that was ever considered, well, maybe not the first material, but certainly the first perovskite oxide that was considered in this approach was barium titanate. And you have here beautifully all parameters computed ab initio, no experimental information, and you have the beautiful sequence of ferroelectric transitions of barium titanate perfectly reproduced. So at high temperatures, here I'm showing you the average value of the polarization along the three spatial directions. So at high temperatures, the polarization is zero everywhere, in each, every direction. At some point, one component becomes different from zero. This is a tetragonal phase. Later, if I keep cooling down, the second component becomes different from zero and equal to the first one, and I'm in an orthorhombic structure, and eventually the three of them become equal and different from zero, and I have the low temperature rhombohedral phase of barium titanate. So this is exactly what happens experimentally. The only catch is that the transition temperatures are a bit off, but otherwise this works very, very well. Is it better, even better than that? If you compute response properties, which are relatively simple thing to do in this scheme, there was a pointer around here. Well, somebody stole the pointer? Because mine. Thank you. You can compute responses, and you see here the temperatures were scaled to compare with experiment, but essentially here this is the electric response, susceptibility, sorry, very beautiful near divergence at the transition temperature, and the clear symmetry breaking. Here you have the three components in the diagonal. They split into two different components, parallel and perpendicular to the polarization in the tetragonal phase. And here. And here the solid symbols are experimental values and the open symbols are theory. And you can see that this really is doing something well. Here you have the results for the piezoelectricity. It works, it really works. Okay, so this is a very nice approach that has been used over many years with great success. And if you know a little bit of ferroelectrics, this was applied very successfully to, for instance, lead zirconium titanate to understand the phase diagram or why this material is such a good piezoelectric, to bismuth ferrite to understand the transitions in temperature of this material. Many, many things have been done, very successful. But we have also found over the years that when you go to more and more complex cases, things become more and more complicated. here we have to really know a lot about the material before we start to produce a model. We have to know which are the local degree of freedoms that are important, which kind of interactions, which are the ground states we want to reach to see which kind of couplings we need to include. So you really need to know a lot. And if you go to a superlattice, for example, it becomes even more complicated. You have, in principle, to define these local modes as something that may depend on which layer that is close or far from the interface, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I could enumerate here situations. There are a bunch of them that are more and more relevant scientifically and that become more and more untractable with this original approach. Okay. So, plus, by the way, this original approach, as successful as it is for ferroelectrics, it hasn't been used anywhere else in material science, which is a strike. So thinking about it, we realize that the problem essentially is here. So there is a very drastic approximation that you do, which is to simplify. Essentially, you forget about the atoms, and you work with variables, effective variables, that correspond to some specific pattern of distortions. And this is a killer. I think this is probably the reason why nobody outside ferroelectrics have worked with these models, because you know they are simply not used to doing to thinking in these terms, or maybe in some materials it's difficult to make this reduction. Okay. And making this reduction also becomes increasingly difficult if you go to more complicated solids. So our approach to the problem, to tackle this problem, is to simply remove it. So instead of reducing the number of degrees of freedom, here we are winning a factor of 5 as compared with all the degrees of freedom we have. And we thought, do we really need this factor of 5? The computers have sped up by much more than a factor of 5. So maybe we can simply do everything. And so that's what we are doing now. And that's very good. Well, these are the people who did it, Jacek Boydu, Carlos Escorihuela, these couple of papers. So treating the whole material, all the atoms, is extremely, it's a relief, it's because it makes life extremely simple. Because now I can write the energy of my material. You saw it was like a Taylor series in the amplitudes of these distortions, but I had to know which distortions. Now I simply put here how each and every one of the atoms in my system moves from some reference structure, and I can write, you know, harmonic terms, anharmonic terms. I can put here strains. I can write a strain phonon couplings, essentially of arbitrary form, in a straightforward manner for any material that I want to study. Then you can use, of course, these potentials don't need to be general. I have to truncate in the order of the expansion at some point. Fine, that's an approximation, but this is an approximation that can be automatically or very simply improved upon. I have to truncate the spatial extension of the interactions. Again, this is an approximation, but again, an approximation that I can improve very easily. I can use symmetry to reduce the number of couplings that actually are non-zero, et cetera, et cetera. So it's really very, very advantageous. We still have the what I told you before. We cannot break bonds. This is still a quasi-perturbative approach. But still, you know, if we remain without breaking bonds, this is very simple in principle. It's a great simplification. Okay. So how do we go about fitting this new model with all the atoms? So the procedure is very straightforward. What we want to do is, ab initio, we run a molecular dynamic simulation. So we take a relatively small cell. It's not written here. So for a strontium titanate, we take a strontium titanate in a cell of 2 by 2 by 2 unit cells, periodically repeated. This means 40 atoms. We start in the cubic phase, and we let the system go at 10 Kelvin using some sort of thermostat that are very standard in first principle simulations. So the system first typically heats up quickly, and eventually it goes to lower energy configurations. So here the system is cubic, and over here the structural distortions in strontium titanate that are rotations of oxygen octahedra, they have kicked in and have managed to reduce the symmetry from the cubic phase. But the point here is that I can run this simulation without knowing anything about the system. Okay? I start, I know what to do, I let go, and I let the forces take the system from the high symmetry phase to the low symmetry phase by themselves. Okay? I run this one, by the way, at 10 Kelvin, so in this case, the system really goes to the low symmetry phase because I'm running at quite low temperature. Okay, I do that. What is the second step? Then I define how complex my model can be. So I come back here and I make these decisions. Okay, I want to consider all the interactions up to fourth order, all the interactions up to a certain spatial range, all the interactions up to whatever. I make those decisions, and I write down how many interactions I have. For the typical case of strontium titanate, I end up with 500 independent parameters that in principle can be satisfy this criteria. Okay? So that's quite a lot. And then of course the question is, how do I choose the important ones? So I have a model with 500 numbers to fit to try to reproduce this trajectory. And the question is how I choose the important ones. And here, well, it would be a little bit of a long story, but our models have a very, very important advantage, which is that they are polynomial, and the parameters to fit, which are these numbers here, the energy is linear in all the parameters to fit. Okay? Depends linearly on the parameters. And therefore, I can formulate the fitting problem by doing the following. So I define an error function or a goal function that I need to minimize. It's a sum over configurations, over steps in this molecular dynamics run. And I compare the forces given by the model for a given set of parameters to be determined. I compare them with the forces in my training set, with the forces obtained from DFT. And I want to minimize the difference between these forces. Okay? I can also do it for the stresses of the cell, but let's stay with the forces. I want to minimize the differences. Now, the forces given by the model are linear in the parameters. So this is a quadratic form of all the parameters. It's like a parabola in many dimensions. Okay? So this parabola, in principle, has a minimum. This is a positive defined function, so it has a minimum, and that minimum corresponds to my optimum choice of parameters to reproduce my training set. Okay? So it means that I can find parameters by simply solving a system of linear equations, or in other words, by diagonalizing a matrix, which is very, very good news. Okay. So this is an outstanding advantage that we have, which is the models are linear in the parameters. For instance, this is something that Marcelo doesn't have, and many other models don't have. And by doing that, we can, so by taking advantage of this, that is very fast fit, what we do is to first, so we have these possible parameters to reproduce the training set. And the first thing we do is to find a parameter that is the most important. So we try to find the best model of only one parameter. This, of course, is ridiculous. This model is not physically relevant, but this procedure, you know, to try to see which parameter allows us to minimize the best this goal function. If I consider models with all only one parameter, and I consider all of them, all the possible ones, allows us typically to identify indeed which one is the most important coupling. And once I have the first one, I fix it. That one belongs to my model already, and I consider all the other ones to identify the best model of two parameters. And I continue like this, okay, until I get the best model of whatever, n parameters, which is accurate enough. Okay? So it works extremely well to show you that. This is, for example, the results for the harmonic part of the energy, which can be evaluated very easily by comparing what I get, let's say, for the phonons at the gamma point or at different points in the Burian zone, from ab initio and from my model. And as a function of parameters, you see how my model eventually nails down with perfect accuracy the ab initio results. This is when I fit the harmonic part of the model. So I am fitting, by the way, here only at 10 Kelvin, if I remember correctly, but I am showing you how my model reproduces the energetics of a molecular dynamics trajectory, ab initio molecular dynamics, at 10 Kelvin and also at 300 Kelvin. And you see that as I increase the number of parameters, eventually I can reproduce the energies essentially in a perfect way. So actually for the models we use, the deviation of the energies per formula unit is as small as that, below 1 mV. So this is extremely good. We have to be slightly careful with one little problem, which is overfitting. So anyone who has fit to models that are very, very good, very complete, has a situation like this. So imagine you have a real function, which is the red curve. You take values, the samples of that function, that's your information that you need to fit, and you use a model that is too good, so the model will fit to this horrible thing, and then this model will not be predictive, because instead of giving you the smooth behavior, it gives you a crazy behavior. So we have to be a little bit careful to avoid overfitting, but there are ways to do that, and essentially get the model that looks like that. This is an example of how we do it, but I'm going to skip it, and in the end, things work very well. So here, for example, I'm showing you what we get when we fit a model to information from DFT molecular dynamics at 10 Kelvin and 300 Kelvin. This is fitted, and the model reproduces the ab initio data quite well. And this is predicted. This is information that we didn't use to fit, and it's also quite well reproduced. In particular, the energy change of typical configurations that are explored at 10 Kelvin with respect to typical configurations that are explored at 200 Kelvin, this energy difference comes out very, very precisely, which is very important if we want to there later predict properties of these things as a function of temperature. Okay, that's a detail. So just to show you how it works, for lead titanate, very quickly, doing the implementing these kind of ideas, we get models that are very, very accurate. Excellent agreement. Okay, you can find the results in this paper. And now you are going to see something that was a bit frustrating for us. Oh, no, sorry, before the frustration. Oh, you don't have the frustration here. Ah, yeah, here. Okay. Once we have the new models, what is interesting is that once we have the new models, we start to discover new things, unexpected results, almost immediately. For example, this is an exercise we did. You know that titanate usually has a single transition from paraelectric to ferroelectric. That's it. But here, just for fun, we consider lead titanate, but forcing the cell to remain cubic, to remain like in the high symmetry phase at all temperatures. Okay? And then what we have is that at some temperature there is a transition from paraelectric to a ferroelectric phase, so we develop polarization. This polarization is not to a tetragonal phase, now it's to a rhombohedral phase. Okay, that's a bit different, but that was already known. It was known from ab initio calculations that if you to lead titanate, you impose the constraint that the cell has to be cubic, the low symmetry phase is not tetragonal, it's rhombohedral like this one. But what is interesting is that you keep reducing the temperature, there is a second transition that involves rotation of the octahedra, and this had never been seen before. Not ab initio, experimentally of course these are kind of difficult to attain conditions, but ab initio this had been missed completely. And our model was predicting this. So okay, we thought probably our model is wrong, and what we did was to verify explicitly, running additional ab initio calculations, that this is indeed the lowest energy structure where lead titanate is constrained elastically to retain a cubic cell. So we fit our model without this kind of information. This is something we didn't know. But in the fit, in the information we put in the parameters, we are actually putting the model, we are making a wise model that is able to predict things that we didn't know in advance. And this happens on a daily basis with our models, which is great. And this couldn't happen with the previous simpler models, by the way, which for lead titanate in particular, generally ignore these degrees of freedom altogether. Okay, how does it compare with experiment? So here you have the phase transition of lead titanate as calculated by our model. And it's very nice. This profile actually, if you compare with experiment of polarization as a function of temperature, it compares very, very well, but there is only one problem. The transition temperature is 510 Kelvin, but experimentally is this one. So this was very frustrating for us because lead titanate had already been studied with the kind of simpler approach that they have introduced at the beginning by Karin Rafe, and they had this result. They had a phase transition that was much closer to experiment than ours, which is definitely not what we were expecting. So we tried very hard to understand what was going on, and this is just to tell you that we were doing everything essentially very well. And finally, we observed a main difference between these two models, or one important difference. In this model, we have all the atoms. The lattice can do whatever it wants, okay? When you observe the actual system, you only see the polarization. But in principle, there can be other distortions, other phonons that are fluctuating there, and that you never observe experimentally. You don't pay attention to them because they don't give you any phase transition. In this model, instead, they only had electric dipoles. So they were disregarding completely all other or many other phonons that in principle are there in the lattice. So what we did was to run the following computational experiment. We run as before the phase transition when we consider all the possible atomic displacements that can happen in our realistic material, like here, as indicated here, we have arrows everywhere. And here, what we did was to say, no, for the oxygens, we are not going to let them do whatever they want. They can only move like this, along this kind of apical directions, which are the ones important for ferroelectricity, but they cannot move in the equatorial planes, which are the directions important, for example, to have rotations, rotations like this one. So by constraining the movement of the oxygens, we were eliminating the possibility of having this kind of phonons vibrating all together, okay? And when we do that, we obtain a completely different transition temperature, okay? So the rotations, the tilts, still don't appear anywhere. Okay, sorry, they don't appear here, they have been canceled. Here they don't appear anywhere, but they were there. There were fluctuations, of course, and these rotations compete with the polarization, okay? And as soon as you suppress them, it's much easier for the polarization to order, and therefore the transition temperature gets pushed up by almost 400 degrees over there. Okay? So these kind of things, and of course you can do a little theory to understand. So there is an effective coupling between the polar order and the rotations, whose average value is always zero, but of course the average for fluctuations of the square of the amplitude is different from zero, and these guys renormalize the energy of the polarization. So very easy to understand, a posteriori very obvious, but impossible to know if you use a simpler model. Okay, so this is just anticipation of what will come tomorrow. So we have some time ago already moved from simple bulk materials like lead titanate to consider more complex situation. And the first thing we did was to consider the superlattices of lead titanate and strontium titanate for a work with Pablo Subko that I'm not going to describe in this conference. But okay, I have shown you these beautiful vortices or multi-domain configuration with this kind of vortices before. This is a microscopic image, and this is what we get from our models just by running the simulation without doing anything special. And as you can see, even the length, the characteristic length of the width of the domains, etc., come out very nicely. So we can have access now to this kind of complex dipole orders in a very straightforward manner. And here there is a very interesting aspect, which is that in the TEM image, you only see the dipoles in plane. Okay? While here in the simulation, the dipoles in plane are given by arrows, and you can see them, but the colors refer to the polarization out of plane. Okay? And here inside the domains, well, it's complicated, but particularly at the domain walls, at these cores, you see that we have a relatively large polarization out of plane, pointing towards you over there, and pointing again away from you over here. And this is very interesting because this, if you now spend some time using mirror planes, etc., you could realize that this structure is chiral, which couldn't be decided from these experimental images, but actually was measured in a different experiment by the same group that synthesized these superlattices. So we believe this gives us some support. I mean, the only way we have found to explain chirality, the measurements of chirality in these materials, is this kind of interesting structure at the ferroelectric domain walls, which is invisible in these microscopic images, but is revealed by our models. So final slide. Just let me show you a cool movie to see what kind of things we can do. So here you have the same superlattice as before, but now we are going to take a section. We are going to take this plane over here. Okay, this is the lowest energy configuration at 0 Kelvin. And what I'm going to show you is a movie of how this this plane, and we are going to look at the polarization from above. So we are going to be see down polarization and up polarization regions in two different colors. You are going to see how this thing looks like when we go to 400 Kelvin. So at 400 Kelvin, we have thermal activation, of course, and the domains, the domain wall motion, becomes spontaneously possible. So essentially, it's not so costly to move domain walls in this material, and at 400 Kelvin, they simply move. So we have something that we name domain liquid in this paper, and which is very beautiful. And it's very interesting topologically, or here, well, I mean, that would be a longer discussion. Part of it will happen tomorrow. But these are things, this is just to tell you that these are things that we can do today. So if you are more interested in all these things, you can go to that website. And I'm not going to discuss this because I'm not sure I want this to appear in the video. The code, in principle, is available under restricted conditions, but eventually this will improve. Just to give you a feeling of the things that we are doing now, we are generalizing our lattice models to consider chemically inhomogeneous situations, like solid solutions, but also like superlattices as the ones you showed. But those models were constructed by hand in some sense, and when we want to automatize that. At the electronic level, we are implementing the possibility, well, we are improving a lot the way we generate electronic models, which was primitive in the first in the first draft of the codes. And we are implementing the possibility of running dynamics for the electrons, so solving the time-dependent Schrodinger equation, so to speak. And well, We are very committed to modularity and integrating with other packages, but that's not so relevant here. So here you have the references where you can find all the information of things I've been telling you. And that's it. Thank you for your